So, bismillah, alhamdulillah, wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Rabbi yassir wa a'in rabbal alameen, rabbi a'in ala dhikrika wa shukrika wa husni ibadatik. So, inshallah, tonight we're doing two hadiths. Now one, you would typically would do one hadith, right? Today, inshallah, we're doing two. And because they are similar and close to each other, and both of them show the consequence, inshallah, the consequence of connecting what you say to your heart. And having what you say really emanate and come deep inside your heart. So the importance, the virtue of conviction, iman, belief. And that the more that you have of it, the more that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rewards us for the acts that we do or the things that we say. More than you imagine. More than someone who is disconnected from his heart. Disconnected from ikhlas and yaqeen and all of this, inshaAllah. So, today is the... So, we'll go through the 18th hadith and then the 19th hadith. And next week, inshaAllah, will be the 20th hadith. Bi'idhnillah. And that would have concluded half of the book, inshaAllah. So the 20th hadith, by the 20th hadith, half of the book. And the week after, wallahu alam, but I'll announce it next week. The week after, probably we may give it to you off because it's the last 10 days. So we'll see how it goes. We'll ask you next week, inshallah. Maybe the week after is off because it's the first weekend after Eid. And then we'll, inshallah, re-adjourn after, inshallah. We'll meet afterwards, inshallah. So let's start, inshallah, with the hadith 18. Here, قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم إني لأعلم كلمة لا يقولها عبد حقا من قلبه فيموت على ذلك إلا حرم على النار لا إله إلا الله. So again, إني لأعلم كلمة. I know a sentence that no worshipper of Allah, no person says it حقا من قلبه, truly from his heart. So that's the important part here that connects this hadith to the series. Truly from his heart. And he dies upon that. إِلَّا حُرِّمَ عَلَى النَّارِ except that he would be protected from hellfire. لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ. So this is the statement that if a person says truly from their heart, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protects them from hellfire. كلمة التوحيد. So we've seen in the last hadith how an act of worship, when it's done sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, remember the wudu that we talked about, when it's done really for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and awareness, then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives a lot of reward for it. So there's a difference between an act and an act. An act that is aware, an act that is committed with a heart close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and an act that is done as out of habit, or an act with a heart that is distant from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So there's a difference between the two. Here, everybody says La ilaha illallah. Every single Muslim, right? As long as they are honestly Muslims, all of them say La ilaha illallah. But we'll see inshaAllah in the explanation that not every Muslim who says La ilaha illallah gets the same reward and benefit from La ilaha illallah. It really depends on your heart. And how much of La ilaha illallah is in your heart and is in my heart. Then you'll get the full benefit of La ilaha illallah. So, remember that before we talked about the many diseases of the heart. You know, we talked about the shahawat, we talked about the shubuhat, we talked about envy, we talked about arrogance, al-kibr, we talked about shuh. The greatest disease among all the diseases of the heart is shirk. The greatest disease among all the diseases of the heart is shirk. Because all the other diseases are major sins to have in the heart. Like envy, like arrogance. They're major sins. But still a person may possess them, but remain a Muslim. So the heart has corruption in it, but is not fully and completely corrupt. So here we'll understand the danger of shirk. A person could have arrogance, and it's a major sin. And we said in the hadith, if you remember it before, that a person who has this shall not enter paradise. Meaning that they will deserve to go to hellfire to be purified of this sin. But they're still Muslim. they're still eventually بإذن الله, as long as they're Muslim, they'll go to heaven. A person who has shirk, major shirk in their heart, doesn't go to heaven. So this tells us that the greatest corruption of the heart, the greatest disease of the heart, is the disease of shirk. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغْفِرُ أَن يُشْرَكَ بِهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive that people associate others with Him, and He forgives anything else beyond that to whomever He wishes. So the door is open for forgiveness for any other sin other than shirk. But when it comes to shirk, a person has it and they die upon it without repentance and they meet Allah with it, does it get forgiven? No. So that tells you really that the greatest corruption and the greatest disease in the heart is the disease of shirk. And we want to understand, inshaAllah, briefly, because we've talked about this before. If you refer back, inshaAllah, to hadith number 15, we've discussed why shirk, why having someone with Allah or instead of Allah in the heart is so problematic. What does it do to the heart? So we discussed it in hadith 15, so I'll refer you back to it, inshaAllah. But we want to understand also, why is it such an unforgiven sin? And when you think about shirk, why is it that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of all the sins that we commit, this sin He does not forgive? And there are two reasons, inshaAllah, that I will discuss today. One is the favors of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon all of us. The great favors of Allah upon us. And the great rights we owe Allah. How much we owe Him because of all of these ni'mas that He has given us. And the second thing, the absolute and certain knowledge that we have that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there and that Allah is one and that we need to worship Him. These two reasons. And that will illustrate, inshaAllah, why shirk is such a grave sin. The first one is Allah's ni'mah is upon us. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, وَمَا بِكُم مِّن نِعْمَةٍ فَمِنَ اللَّهِ. Every ni'mah that you have comes to you from Allah. Every single ni'mah that you have comes to you from Allah. Then Allah says, ثُمَّ إِذَا مَسَّكُمُ الضُّرُّ فَإِلَيْهِ تَجْأَرُونَ. Then when hardship touches you, who do you turn to? You turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. ثُمَّ إِذَا كَشَفَ الضُّرَّ عَنْكُمْ إِذَا فَرِيقٌ مِّنْكُمْ بِرَبِّهِمْ يُشْرِكُونَ. Then when He removes this hardship, because you went back and you asked Allah and you pleaded with Allah. When He removes this hardship away, what do you do afterwards? Then members of you, a part of you, they go back and they take partners with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning during times of hardship, you all recognize that no one can help you but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. All of us. Whether it's the example that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says you're on board a ship and it starts, moving left and right in waves like mountains. And then you realize you're very close to your death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, at that moment you leave all of your partners and you turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If you were on the shore, on land, you trusted yourself and your wisdom and your power and your money and your family and your position and all of this. And you had shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in worshipping another idol or another person. When in you really in true hardship, you know that you can't depend on anyone, including yourself, mainly yourself. You can't depend on yourself. You're powerless when it comes to true and, actual hardship and danger. So you know that you can't depend on yourself. And everyone around you is as weak as you are. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, that إِنَّ الَّذِينَ تَدْعُونَ مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ عِبَادٌ أَمْثَالُكُمْ. That those that you are calling, other than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, are just ibad, slaves like you. So if they are slaves like you, they are powerless like you. So you recognize during hardship that no one can help you but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So during times when we are healthy and wealthy and all of this, when you consider all the ni'mas that Allah had given you, or consider all the ni'mas, you'll know that all these ni'mas have come to you from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you try to count them, you won't be able to count them. Now, the right that we owe to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of all of these ni'mas is the greatest right. Yani no other being has rights upon us as much as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, let's understand this, move from our relationship with Allah to our relationship with people. Who is the person who has the greatest right? Human. Who is the person who has the greatest right on you? Who is it?
Parents.
Why the parents? Why specifically the parents? They did so much for you, right? They brought you into existence. And they took care of you when you're weakest. If they were to leave you, you would die. Definitely die. Perish. So they took care of you when you needed them the most. And even if that hurt them, they did that. And even if they had to sacrifice, they did that for your sake. And they continue to do it. And they continue to do it. And until they die, they continue to worry about you. And if they can, they'll continue to take care of you. So this is the parents. Because they have done the most for you, they deserve most of your respect and honor and help and care. Right? So the greatest, you know, ni'mah, let's say, the greatest service that they have done to you equals the greatest right that you owe to them. This with that. The more that they do to you, for you, the more that you have to give to them. So this is true with humans. So this is why we honor the parents the most. Now if you think about it, subhanAllah, who gave you your parents? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who gave them the love that they have for you? You know, as an exception, there are some parents who actually give birth to children and they just abandon them. They have no feelings for them. That's an exception. But imagine it, right? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put the love that they have for you in their hearts. And the care that they can, your mother cannot sleep until she makes sure that you are fine. Your father cannot sleep when you're sick until he goes and buys you medicine. Who had put all of that care and love in their hearts? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Who gave you the parents to begin with? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In fact, when you think about it, any love that you receive from the people around you, who gave them the ability to love you? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Anyone who has done you a favor, who had put in their hearts the desire to do this favor to you and the physical ability to give you that good thing to you, bring it closer to you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has more favors upon you than any other human being. And then besides humanity, you just look at the ni'mas that you have: sight, hearing, body, consciousness, ability to speak, to think, to do things, to decide, and you keep thinking about it and thinking about it and thinking about it. And the deeper that you think, if you just think about the eye and you dissect it and you go deep inside hearing and you go deep inside, you'll find that there's one ni'mah after another, one ni'mah after another, one ni'mah after another. And subhanAllah, as they say, you're drowning in Allah's ni'mah. You look left and right, you're drowning in Allah's ni'mah. You cannot even count them. You cannot even encompass them. And obviously you can't thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for them. And this is something, inshaAllah, is useful to think about whenever you think and I think we don't have enough. You know, we don't have enough of money, or we don't have enough of whatever it is, you know, that we desire in this life. Wife, children, house, whatever it is. I didn't have enough of this. Go back and consider all the ni'mas that Allah had given you and all the harm that Allah had protected you from, that you are aware of and that you're not aware of. Just driving to here and back, that you did not get into an accident. You did not get into a fight. That you are actually safe. That is a ni'mah, that is protection. And you think about it continuously, how many times Allah protects you from harm and continues to do this. If you're sitting here healthy, that is a ni'mah. If you're sitting with one disease, that's also a ni'mah, because you don't have more than that. SubhanAllah. So you keep thinking about it, that is the greatest favors that we have in our lives come from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we owe Him the most. So when you take another partner with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and start attributing these ni'mas to him, or to it, or to her, whatever it is, then that's the greatest injustice. Like it would be if you go and insult your parents. And then you attribute whatever you have to a stranger and you say, he's the one who took care of me, and he didn't do anything. He's the one who protected me, and he didn't do anything. That's the greatest injustice, right? Just like this, shirk is the greatest injustice. So that's one reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not forgive him. Because if you think about the greatest dhulm, that is the greatest dhulm. More than killing another being. That's a dhulm. But subhanAllah, humanity, when we consider, if you ask people in general, especially non-Muslims, and what is the greatest crime? Killing people. Killing a person. It is really a heinous crime to kill another human being, unjustly. You can't do it. It's haram, absolutely. But the greatest dhulm than that is that the one who has the greatest right upon you gets denied. Not just one single being, because this being that you've killed, this human being that you've killed, has rights on you. But these rights could be great or not so great. Still, it's haram to kill him. But the one who's on above this human being, who has the greatest right upon you, and you say, I don't recognize any right that you have on me. None. I don't worship you, I don't listen to you, I don't live my life according to you. That is the greatest injustice. The other one, the other reason, is that now knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the clearest and more certain knowledge that we have. More than any other knowledge. SubhanAllah, they say that it is actually more than knowing that the sun is right outside now, shining and illuminating the world. It's more than that. More than the knowledge that the moon is out there. More than the knowledge that I'm sitting and talking to you. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says on the tongue of the prophets of Allah, قَالَتْ رُسُلُهُمْ أَفِي اللَّهِ شَكٍّ فَاطِرِ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. So their messengers told the people, is there any doubt about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the creator of the heavens and the earth? Meaning what? There is no doubt. There can be no doubt about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because of what you observe and because of what you feel. What you observe is what? When you come out to this world and you start realizing things around you, you immediately realize that everything has something behind it. Everything that has something behind it. A child, right? When you observe a child, you will see that the child makes this connection very early on. Somebody throws something, child after some time learns that when somebody throws a ball, if he doesn't see the person who threw it, he'll look to see who threw it. He'll make that connection early on. Cause and effect. So we realize early on, as you come out into this world and realize it, this is a great, magnificent thing, it has someone behind it. That's one of the earliest things that you will realize. There's something great behind this. And also, you have in your heart and in my heart that desire and that knowledge of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that necessity that pushes you to seek a creator. So knowledge of the creator, they say it's certain among humans. Humans only come later to deny it. So most of humanity, by the way, they don't deny a creator. Khaliq, they don't deny that. They might dispute the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They might dispute that. But the overwhelming majority of humanity today and throughout history, do they deny a creator? No, they don't. So it's a necessary knowledge that all of us have. Indisputable knowledge. That comes from deep inside, we realize, yes, there is someone greater than I am. And once you actually affirm that there's someone greater than you are, you feel this comfort and peace in you. And when you deny it, as soon as you deny it, you feel a great discomfort and loss. You enter into a world of chaos. Because that's the principle that organizes your life. You know, one of the atheists, who happened also to read the Qur'an, have said, and they used to read the Qur'an, they stopped, but they said, the only thing that I remember from the Qur'an, and it rings so true for me, is وَمَنْ أَعْرَضَ عَنْ ذِكْرِي فَإِنَّ لَهُ مَعِيشَةً ضَنْكَ. The one who turns away from my remembrance will have a miserable existence, a tough existence, right? A depressed existence. He says, I'm feeling this every day. Right? Though he decided, I'm not, you know, still ready to believe, but he says, I'm feeling this, like without knowledge of a creator, this is a miserable existence that I have. It doesn't have any meaning. Void of any meaning. So this is a knowledge that is necessary there in the hearts. So when you go and deny that, you're denying something that is so essential and basic that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, this is something that I cannot forgive. With all of my messages that I sent and messengers and the world around you testifying that there's a creator and this creator is one. And what I've given you of internal evidence that Allah is one, and you're still denying Allah, you have no excuse anymore. So who's saying this? Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahman who's saying this, the most merciful. So you know that if the most merciful is saying, up to here and I cannot forgive it, you will know that this is unforgivable. Right? Now, shirk, subhanAllah, also, you can add to it why it's also the most unforgiven sin, or the only unforgiven sin, it spreads the most corruption on the face of this earth. The most corruption. Corruption is tied to shirk, and shirk is tied to corruption. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يُعْجِبُكَ قَوْلُهُ فِي الْحَيَاةِ الدُّنْيَا وَيَشْهُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا فِي قَلْبِهِ وَهُوَ أَلَدُّ الْخِصَامِ. He says, of people are those whose speech you admire in this world. So when they speak well. وَيَشْهُدُ اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا فِي قَلْبِهِ. And he makes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a witness as to what he has in his heart. وَهُوَ أَلَدُّ الْخِصَامِ. And he is the fiercest of opponents. Then he says, وَإِذَا تَوَلَّى سَعَى فِي الْأَرْضِ لِيُفْسِدَ فِيهَا وَيُهْلِكَ الْحَرْثَ وَالنَّسْلِ. And when he goes away, he strives to spread corruption throughout the land and to destroy crops and animals. And Allah does not like corruption. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tied there, connected, that disbelief that a person has in the heart and spreading corruption on this earth. So you have to understand that iman equals reform of this earth. Reform because the mu'min will reform it and improve on it, and Allah will bless it. And disbelief, right? Shirk, kufr in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is corruption on this earth. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will take the blessing away, and the person who has this shirk and or disbelief in their heart, if they're not listening to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and right and wrong, and the one who has the greatest right upon them, and they don't respect these rights, why would they respect your rights? You understand what I'm saying? If this person does not respect the rights that belong to the Creator, and that Creator has the greatest rights upon them, the greatest favors upon them, why would this person respect your rights? Why would he hold back his greed and envy and arrogance? Why won't he destroy you when he has a chance to destroy you? That's why the world today is civil only because they fear each other. Because I fear you, the great powers or not so great powers, because they're afraid of each other, they keep these laws intact. But when they're able to escape punishment and escape scrutiny and actually do something to harm another being or another country without being caught, they do it. Am I wrong? They do it. Right? And then when you catch them, they say, no, it's not us. First, it's not us. We didn't do it. We deny. Denial is the best strategy. We didn't do it. After 5-10 years, when nobody's paying attention, then they release papers and they tell you, yes, they were well aware that all of these things were done with full intention, with full knowledge. That where are all of these principles that we were talking about, the human rights and all of this? There is no fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the fear of Allah is not there, they'll do anything to you. As long as no one can catch them. If people can catch them, oh no. Then they have to stop. Because then they have to explain. Then people may reciprocate. Then they may be punished for it. Or embarrassed because of it. Or harmed because of it. So they don't want that. So that's why the reasons, that's why people uphold laws today, especially international laws. But other than that, a mu'min, whether a person is watching or not, he has Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala watching. He's not gonna, a true mu'min, he's not gonna kill you if he's angry just because no one is watching. He's not gonna commit that act because Allah is watching. So there's a difference between corruption and non-corruption when it comes to who has iman and who doesn't. Now, we'll move here to what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. He says, La ilaha illallah. But he put here a condition. There's a clause, right? Not just anyone. La ilaha illallah haqqan min qalbih. Truly from his heart. Because see, we as human beings, we say a lot of things. We talk a lot. And sometimes we mean what we say and sometimes we don't mean it. And sometimes we say, you know, yeah, I believe in this. Yeah, I'm going to be there tomorrow. Yeah, I mean, I'm a supporter of this. But when you actually inquire and push this being and test them, you'll discover really that they didn't believe in any of this. Or their iman in it is, you know, is soft. You know, I believe in this cause. Yes, we should do something to for this sake or that sake. You plan a meeting, people don't show up for the meeting. So what happened? There's no strong commitment to it. So all of us say La ilaha illallah. But who means La ilaha illallah? Who truly believes in La ilaha illallah? So the ulama said that when you collect the hadiths and you collect also the statements in the Quran, it tells you that La ilaha illallah has in it conditions. To fulfill La ilaha illallah, you need conditions. As some of the Salaf have said, you know, La ilaha illallah is the key to Jannah. Right? Like if you imagine that the gates of Jannah have a keyhole, and La ilaha illallah is a physical key. La ilaha illallah is the key to Jannah. It's true in the sense that you can only enter Jannah if you have La ilaha illallah. Then he said, yes, but every key has teeth. Right? So it doesn't work without these teeth. So you have to fulfill La ilaha illallah, and not just come with a statement, oh, I just have La ilaha illallah with me. Okay, what about the teeth of the key? As they said, لِلْمِفْتَاحِ أَسْنَانِ. Where are this asnan? So they say that there are conditions. And some of them counted these conditions, I think, up until 7 or so. Conditions for La ilaha illallah. So some of them is what? Where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَسْعَدُ النَّاسِ بِشَفَاعَةِ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ مَنْ قَالَ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ خَالِصًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ أَوْ نَفْسِهِ. He said, the person who would be happiest with my intercession on the Day of Judgment is the person who says La ilaha illallah khalisan, with ikhlas, with sincerity from his heart. Meaning for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. With deep connection to Allah. Right? No other motivation but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the person who says, I want to receive the shafa'ah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the intercession, where you will be saved from hellfire and enter into heaven. Who is the person who can receive it? The person who says La ilaha illallah, but you also have to have ikhlas with it, sincerity. You're genuine when you say it. Another hadith says, صِدْقًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ, honestly from his heart. Another hadith says, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam told one of the Sahaba, مَنْ لَقِيْتَ مِنْ وَرَاءِ هَذَا الْحَائِطِ يَشْهَدُ أَنْ لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا اللَّهِ مُسْتَيْقِنًا بِهَا قَلْبُهُ فَبَشِّرْهُ بِالْجَنَّةِ. He says to one of the Sahaba, he says, go outside this garden, behind this wall. Whenever you see, or if you see someone who says La ilaha illallah with certainty of belief inside, then give him the good news of Jannah. So having yaqeen, certainty, there's no doubt. You know? There's no doubt. He's not iffy about it. But certain, absolutely certain that there is La ilaha illallah. Meaning that there is only one creator, one sustainer, one Rabb. And the only one who deserves to be worshipped is this Rabb. This is La ilaha illallah. No one else deserves to be worshipped by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One creator, I'm going to only worship this creator and no one else. So, the person who says La ilaha illallah must have what? Must have devotion to this kalima. Yani I'm fully committed to it. Not just I'm saying it, I'm fully committed to it. And I fully accept it that whatever Allah tells me, weakness, when it comes to sin, is something else. All of us are weak. All of us commit sins. But commitment to it. Whatever Allah tells me to do, I will do. Whatever Allah forbids, I will stay away from. That is, you know, reception of this statement. Completely devoted to it. And also receiving it with complete and full love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That I love Allah more than anyone else. This is the meaning of ibadah. And I fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala more than anyone or anything else. This is the meaning of ibadah. And I will worship Allah and no one else. This is the meaning of ibadah. So when you fulfill all of this, yaqeen, certainty, ikhlas, commitment to it, acceptance of it, and for it to emanate really deep from inside, not from outside the heart, but saying really La ilaha illallah, meaning it comes from deep inside your heart. I will now worship anyone, no matter what happens, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will not give this great love that I have in my heart to anyone, but to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I will not allow my heart to fear anyone more than it fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's really coming from deep inside your heart. You'd be willing to give yourself and sacrifice yourself for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That is a statement. That's not just any casual statement that we say, right? It's not just a statement like saying, I'll see you tomorrow, right? That's really confident statement. That's really a statement that commits your entire being to this one. The one who says that statement is the one who truly says La ilaha illallah. The one who says this statement is the one who is saved from hellfire. Truly. And how is he saved from hellfire? In two ways, bi-idhnillah. In two ways. The first way is that the person who says this with such intensity and strength of iman, this statement will burn any other sin that he commits. Will take away any other sin that he commits. Evidence. The famous hadith, they call it hadith sahibi al-bitaqa. What is this hadith? The Prophet ﷺ says that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to distinguish or extract from my ummah one man and bring him in front of everybody, in front of creation, and will give to this person 99 scrolls. You know a scroll, right? With paper, scroll. Each one of them as far as the eye can see. And what do they have in them? Sins. As far as the eye can see. كُلُّ سُجِلٍ مِثْلُ مَدِّ الْبَصَرِ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will say to him. Right? So 99 scrolls. Imagine, again. 99 scrolls, count them. 1, 2, 3, 4, 10, 20, 30. And each one of them as far as the eye can see. Then Allah will ask them, do you deny anything that is written in these scrolls? Did the angels, the scribes, did they actually treat you unjustly and write something that you did not do? So he will say no. All of it is true. Okay. Then Allah will ask him, do you have an excuse? He will say no. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, no, indeed we have with us for you a hasana. And you will be treated justly today. Then a card will be brought out. And what is in this card is La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. Just a card, not scrolls, but just one card. La ilaha illallah Muhammadun Rasulullah. Then he will be told, bring the scales or attend the way in. Go, because the scales, there'll be one pan, another pan. Now attend the way in. So this man will say, Ya Allah, this card with 99 scrolls, what is it going to do? Look how light it is and how heavy these scrolls are. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you will not be treated unjustly today. So subhanAllah, this is Allah's extreme justice. It's not like, okay, well let's assume everyone is going to see with their eyes where they're going to go and why. So all these scrolls will be put on one hand of the scale, and this single bitaqa will be put on another hand of the scale. And this bitaqa, single bitaqa, will be heavier than the 99 scrolls. And the 99 scrolls become light in relation to this bitaqa. And the Prophet ﷺ says, وَلَا يَثْقُلُ مَعَ اسْمِ اللَّهِ شَيْءٍ. Nothing is heavier than the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the ulama, when they explain this hadith, they say, there are other Muslims who say La ilaha illallah, but their sins are not going to be eradicated and cancelled like this man. They still will go to hellfire, purified, and then they will leave it. Why this particular man? They'll tell you that the conviction of La ilaha illallah that this man had, though he committed these many sins, but the conviction of La ilaha illallah, and that he stayed away from shirk in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. His conviction was so strong that the tawheed, the light of tawheed, evaporated any other sin that was there. And that's the importance of tawheed. Of course, again, so that we don't misunderstand, this again is not a license. I'm just, you know, I'm going to work on my tawheed, do whatever sins you want, right? That's not it. But that this man, as it happens, for him, his la ilaha illallah removed all other sins. So that tells you about the virtue of la ilaha illallah, right? About the virtue of la ilaha illallah. And that the firmer this belief is in my heart and your heart, the greater that it will do, the greater tazkiyah that it will bring to your heart, and the greater protection that it will offer for you on the Day of Judgment, and the greater your iman and connection to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is. Because all of my iman and your iman is this statement, la ilaha illallah. And as we know, another way that la ilaha illallah protects and has a fadl, من كان آخر كلامه لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. The one whose last statement is لا إله إلا الله goes where? Goes to Jannah. So if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you and gives me the favor and the ni'mah, that the last thing we will say is لا إله إلا الله, this person goes to Jannah. And that is a sign of what? Again, that person was very close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah is happy with him. And la ilaha illallah was strong in their life. So that's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala helps them to say la ilaha illallah. Otherwise it'd be difficult. You may tell this person, say la ilaha illallah, and they'll be unable to. Remember Allah before you die, and they'll remember all their worldly interests and concerns, but not la ilaha illallah. All the other worldly things that they used to worry about will float to the surface. When you're about to die, right? When you're about to die, you panic and you try to hold on, right? To whatever is close and dear to you. So whatever is important to you will come to the surface when you die. So if it's money, you'll worry about your money. Take care of my money. You know, make sure nobody messes with it. Take care of my property. That's the thing that you're worried about. If it's only your family, take care of my kids. Nobody does this to them. Take care of my wife. That's the thing that you worry about. So even if you tell them, La ilaha illallah, they can't because they're panicking. So only if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you this thabat, you know, tranquility during that time, you'll have the mind to say, La ilaha illallah, and then pass. So this, if you want to say, La ilaha illallah before you die, we have to say it when you're alive. You have to actually follow it when you're alive. It's not just going to happen miraculously just before you die. If you have actually not lived la ilaha illallah. And then, as much as you have la ilaha illallah, if we are among the people who Allah does not forgive, and we have to first pass through hellfire to be purified of our sins and go to heaven, to Jannah, the more iman and la ilaha illallah you have in your heart, the faster you will leave Jahannam. Of course we don't want to go there. And you want to be completely safe from it. But we just want to tell you that it even helps in Jahannam. And actually being saved from a minute, from an hour, from a day in Jahannam is a great ni'mah. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, he who says la ilaha illallah and has in his heart the weight of a grain of barley will leave hellfire. Then he says, the one who says la ilaha illallah and has in his heart the weight of a grain of wheat will leave hellfire. Then he says, the one who says la ilaha illallah and has in his heart the weight of an ant or a speck, like a speck of, you know, dirt, will leave hellfire. So here, see how the Prophet ﷺ put them in order. The barley is heavier than the wheat, and the wheat is heavier than the speck. So the more that you have, the faster you leave. So if you want to be protected from hellfire, whether or not to enter it completely, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive all of your sins, focus on the tawheed. You want to be protected from hellfire so that you will say this last before you die, focus on your tawheed and your iman and your love for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the more that you have of it, the more that you'll be saved. And importantly, before we finish with this particular hadith, if you want to purify your heart and not have it be corrupted, chase away shirk from your heart. Shirk in loving Allah, shirk in fearing Allah, shirk in tawakkul on Allah, relying on someone else but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, shirk in ibadah, shirk in the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Chase that shirk away. And when Allah is the master of your heart, is the one who's dominant in your heart, that light of tawheed will flow from your heart to the rest of your body. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will chase all disease. Be easier for you and me to treat all diseases in our heart. If the heart is corrupt with shirk, what's left of the heart to be treated? Right? If all this heart, if it has this shirk, if all this heart is going to go to hellfire, what is left of this heart to be treated? How can you treat envy? How can you treat arrogance? Right? How can you treat hatred? So that would be very difficult to treat when Allah is not on your side to help you, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not helping you purify your heart, and is not, you know, supporting you in the process. So tazkiyah equals tawheed, and tawheed equals tazkiyah. Right? So the next hadith, inshaAllah, and the reason I joined these two hadiths, because they're similar. One is talking about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the other one is talking about Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this hadith says, من صلى علي من أمتي صلاة مخلصا من قلبه صلى الله عليه بها عشر صلوات ورفعه بها عشر درجات وكتب له بها عشر حسنات ومحى عنه عشر سيئات. So he says صلى الله عليه وسلم, the one from my ummah who offers one salah for me, meaning اللهم صل على محمد, one offers salah from me, مُخْلِصًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ, sincerely from his heart. Right? That's the connection again. We can say اللهم صلي على محمد, اللهم صلي على محمد, اللهم صلي على محمد 100,000 times, right? But it's here مُخْلِصًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ, إخلاص. صلى الله عليه بها عشر صلوات. Allah will offer for him 10 salawat. I'll explain what that means, what salah means. Allah will offer for him 10 salawat. And Allah will raise him 10 levels. And Allah will give him 10 hasanat, 10 good deeds. And Allah will cancel for him 10 bad deeds. For each salah that you offer for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah will give you, Allah himself will offer salah for you. And then in addition to the other things that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam talked about. Now, why should we give salah and salam? Before I explain what salah and salam is, why should we give salah and salam to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Like when we said, when we spoke about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is the one who has the greatest right upon us? We said Allah. Among humans, who is the one who has the greatest right on you? More than your parents? It's Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? Your parents gave you physical existence. The Prophet ﷺ gave you what type of existence? Spiritual existence, religious existence. Which is the best of the two. The better of the two is physical existence and spiritual existence. The spiritual religious existence is the better of the two types of existences. Because a physical existence without the other one is meaningless. That person will go to hellfire or to go to nowhere. Has no purpose in their life. Physical religious existence is the reason why you and I were created. So he gave you life. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, استجيبوا لله وللرسول إذا دعاكم لما يحييكم. Respond to Allah and to His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam when He calls you to what gives you life. So this iman, this Islam is what gives you life. So Allah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, when Allah gave him this message and he gave, said, deliver it. And he went through all the sacrifices that he went through. Sacrificed his own comfort and his own family and his own reputation and money and home and property and loved one. And he seen his companions be killed and his family members be lost. And his reputation being assailed continuously and he be threatened physically. And every time, never giving up, never letting up, but going to people and saying, say la ilaha illallah, say la ilaha illallah, let me teach you, let me teach you, never giving up on anyone, and being patient and patient and patient in teaching them. To the extent that the Prophet ﷺ said, I have not left anything that will bring you close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but I've told you about it. And I've not left anything that will take you away from the Prophet, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but I have warned you against it. And as a teacher, he said, I have done my job to the fullest. And he brought Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a witness. Yani, Ya Allah, did I deliver? Allahumma fashhad. He asked the people, did I deliver the message? They say yes. He said, Ya Allah, be a witness that I've done everything that you asked me to do. Today, subhanallah, you know, one of us stands, you know, and says, and gives, you know, one reminder. You know, people do this, do this, do this. Then they will say, هَلْ بَلَّغْتَ اللَّهُمَّ فَشَّدْ Ya Allah, did I deliver? Ya Allah, be a witness. The Prophet ﷺ said this towards the end of his life. Not after one or two hadiths. Not after one khutbah or two khutbahs. After so many khutbahs and reminders towards the end of his life, he said, Ya Allah, did I deliver? Ya Allah, be a witness. Right? That I've given all of my life to this. All of my power to this. My entire existence, my day and night. He is, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the human that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the most. And he loved Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. We can't keep going on and on because it doesn't end. Nah? He loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the most. That he said, my heart has no space at that level of khulla. That intense and deep love has no space in it but for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At the next level of love, just mahabba, he loves everybody. But he said at that level of khulla, the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had penetrated my heart so much, it left no space for anybody else. And for me and for you, I can take this brother, this brother, this brother, this brother, all as my khalil, khalil, like my really intense, strong one that I love. For the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you reach such a level, and only two people have reached that level: Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Ibrahim alayhim salam ajma'in. Only two people throughout humanity reached this level. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has the greatest favors upon us, and he's the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves the most. Ana sayyidu waladi Adam yawm al-qiyamah. I'm the best of the children of Adam on the day of judgment. Because of how much we owe him, because of how much we have he has given us, the least that we can do is say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Is to remember him with this dua. Is whenever he is mentioned, we repay him slightly by saying sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And by doing that, we are also earning things for ourselves. And we'll see inshallah some of the benefits of this salah and salam. But what is the meaning of sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? What is salah? Salah is dua. In Arabic, lugha al-arabiyya, as-salatu hiya dua. Salah is dua. So when you're saying salah for someone, you're making dua for them. But in Arabic also, salah depends in meaning, will vary in meaning based on who is saying it. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says salah. As we said in the hadith, Allah will say salah for you. The malaika say salah. And humans say salah. So salah, when it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, it means praise. That Allah is praising you among the angels. And honoring you. And raising your rank. رفعُ الدرجات والثناءُ من الله تعالى. This is salah from Allah. طيب, this is clear. So when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is offering salah for someone, see in the hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah will offer 10 salahs for you. What does 10 salahs for you mean? That Allah will praise you 10 times, raise you 10 times, honor you 10 times, meaning your name is being mentioned among the angels 10 times. And Allah is praising you. So and so said salah upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You're being mentioned. Right? And subhanAllah, just think about it. Ubay ibn Ka'b radiallahu anhu, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came to him and he said, Allah commanded me to read this surah for you. And he said radiallahu anhu, waqad sammani And he said, and he named me, and he cried. Yani he mentioned me by name. You see the honor, huh? He mentioned me by name, and he told me to come, carry this surah and give it to me by name, and he cried. So to hear, to imagine, Allah is going to mention me my name, right? Among the angels of Allah, it's not يعني Sheikh so-and-so with Sheikh so-and-so, Amir Sheikh and so, King so-and-so. No, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talking about you. So you mention one salah, we'll give you this. So this is salah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Salah from the angels are dua for you, for Allah to bless you, give you barakah and forgive you. So when the angels give salah for you, يعني Ya Allah forgive him, Ya Allah give him barakah, Ya Allah bless him, etc., etc. Salah from humans is dua. So when you're giving salah for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're actually making dua for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ya Allah, bless him. Ya Allah, forgive him. Ya Allah, increase his rank. Ya Allah, protect his religion. Ya Allah, protect his followers. Ya Allah, protect his family. Right? Ya Allah, elevate his rank on the day of judgment. Ya Allah, grant him intercession on the day of judgment. Ya Allah, give him the highest station in Jannah. So you're making dua for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when you say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammad. Yani, Ya Allah, I'm making dua for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you're actually making dua for him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also when you say, Allahumma sallim ala Muhammad, or as-salamu ala Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what does it mean? Salam means one of two things. Either safety, meaning, Ya Allah, save Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and continue to protect him during his life and after his death. And protect also his religion, and his reputation, and his name, and his followers, and protect him on the day of judgment, so that there's no harm comes to him, and take care of him. This is what save him, salim. Or it is the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as-salam. When you say alayhi salatu was-salam, when it is with al was-salam, they say one meaning of that is as-salam is one of the names of who? Allah, right? One of the names of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is as-salam. So may the name of Allah as-salam, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep preserving you and protecting you and guarding you and guiding you. Ya Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you're making dua for the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they say, the ulama say, actually, there is no reservations about the fact that you're making dua for him. Because the more that we all are making dua, the higher his level increases in Jannah. That's why the Prophet ﷺ says that after you make the adhan, ask Allah to grant me al-wasila, a station in paradise that is only one person is eligible to get it. Right? فَسَلُوا لِي الْوَسِيلَةِ. Because it's the only person, only stage or level, only one person can get it. So even he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, after the adhan, when you say, وَآتِ مُحَمَّدًا الْوَسِيلَةَ وَالْفَضِيلَةِ, grant Muhammad al-wasila wal-fadilah, وَابْعَثْهُ مَقَامًا مَحْمُودًا الَّذِي وَعَدْتَهُ. This is all dua for Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A dua that you benefit from, Allah rewards you for, and you benefit from when it happens on the Day of Judgment. So say there is no problem with actually people giving this dua to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and this dua benefiting Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So you feel that you're part of something when you're making this dua. Right? And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself says, إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وتسلموا تسليما. Allah and His angels offer salah upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you too offer salah and salam upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So if Allah and his angels do it, we ought to do it. Especially because we are the ones who received all the benefits from him sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The benefit of his da'wah, the benefit of his sunnah, the benefit of his example, the benefit of his teachings. The least that we can do is say sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, I want to tell you inshaAllah about just a couple of benefits of mentioning the name of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and saying sallallahu alayhi wasallam frequently. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, "Inna awla an-nasi bi yawm al-qiyamati aktharuhum alayya salah." The people who will be closest to me on the day of judgment are the people with the most salah upon me. So the more that you say sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the closer that you will be to him. And one of the virtuous times for you to say this is actually on Friday. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Inna salatakum alayya ma'ruda." Your salah, when you offer it, will be presented to me. He doesn't hear it physically, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He doesn't hear it physically. Some people think, subhanAllah, even when they go to the grave of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam and they say, "As-salatu wassalamu alayka ya Rasulullah," that the Prophet could hear them. Evidence, wallahu alam, is that no, the Prophet cannot hear what you're telling him. Because one of the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, whether you're offering it next to the grave or you are in Al-Andalus, it's the same thing. It reaches the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam through the same means. An angel of Allah comes and tells him, so and so gave salat, salah and salam to you. So again, you'll be mentioned, right, to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam by name. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bring his soul back to him. إِلَّا رَدَّ عَلَيَّ اللَّهُ رُوحِي حَتَّى أَرُدَّ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. Allah will bring his soul back to his body so he can give salam back to you. So you'll be mentioned, you'll be remembered, and the Prophet will know about you. So the more that you do this, the more that he'll know about you, and they'll be closer to him on the Day of Judgment. And you will, inshaAllah, bi'idhnillah, you will love him the most. Because this salah, and again the clause is very important, مُخْلِصًا مِنْ قَلْبِهِ, has to come from deep inside, with love, with wanting to be close to him, with appreciating everything that he has done, right? With wanting to follow his sunnah, with appreciating, you know, all the sacrifices that he has done. So when you actually feel this, you say, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. That salah, when it comes out of that heart, comes really with feelings. Sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Like when someone really does something nice to you, and you say, thank you, brother, thank you. Not just thank you, not casual thank you, but thank you. Allah, it's coming from deep inside. So when you say, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that one, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, really comes from deep inside. Na'am, may Allah reward you for this. May Allah elevate your rank for this. May Allah bless you for this. May Allah increase your level in Jannah for this. May Allah keep protecting your name because of all of this. This is sallallahu alayhi wasallam, from deep inside. That's mukhlisan fil qalbi. And that brings love for him, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And you will be with the people that you love on the Day of Judgment, as the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said. And it also chases away stinginess. Stinginess, because he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Al-bakhilu alladhi idha dhukirtu 'indahu falam yusalli 'alayhi." The stingy person, the really stingy person, is the one who, when I'm mentioned, he doesn't offer salah upon me. So we know that when you frequently say sallallahu alayhi wasallam, whenever he's mentioned, it chases away what? One of these grave and important diseases of the heart, bukhl. And the last thing, inshaAllah, that we'll say, when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the more that you mention it, he said to the Sahabi, إِذَنْ تُكْفَى هَمَّكَ وَيُغْفَرُ لَكَ ذَنْبُكَ. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will remove your worries and your sins. Because he asked him, how much of my dua should I give to you? You know? He said, one third of it, one quarter of it, one half of it, all of it. So he said, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, then Allah will remove your worries and your pain and troubles and forgive your sins. So sometimes, subhanAllah, especially when you're feeling it, doesn't mean, because some people when they hear that, they say, should I stop making any other dua and only do this? No. That's not the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He also used to make other du'as. But sometimes, yes. Sometimes, as with the Sahabi, you feel like you really want just to say salah and salam upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You just engage in this for 5, 10 minutes. That's your whole du'a. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam says, Allah will take care of your worries. You don't have to be concerned about this and this and this. Allah will take care of it. And Allah also will remove your sins. So this is what it does. And as the main hadith in this chapter said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala himself will offer salah for you. and you will have 10 salats for you, not just one. For each one you'll have 10, and 10 hasanats, and 10 sayyat will go away, and 10 levels in Jannah bi-idhnillah ta'ala. So in both of these hadiths, saying La ilaha illallah and saying Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you see that the more that you connect them to your heart, the more that they value with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the more that they will bring to you. So that's the benefit of tazkiyah. That's the benefit of ikhlas. That's the benefit of working on your heart continuously until you can say La ilaha illallah sincerely with love. Until you can say Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sincerely. So why should we engage in tazkiyah? This is it. Why should I purify my heart? This is it. If you want the greatest hasanat for the smallest act, this is it. It comes with tazkiyah. So let's inshallah, you know, continue to work on our hearts throughout the month of Ramadan. Cleanse them, purify them, fill them with iman. And as we said, this is a process, bi-idhnillah azza wa jal, that never stops, continues and persists till we meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we ask you, Ya Rabbal Alameen, to purify our hearts and make us of those who say La ilaha illallah truly from their hearts, with ikhlas and with yaqeen and with commitment, so that when we meet you, Ya Rabbal Alameen, we go directly to Jannah without any entry or exposure to hellfire. And make us, Ya Allah, of those who say Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam with ikhlas in our hearts, so that we would get the reward in that hadith. And continue, Ya Rabbal Alameen, to purify our hearts. Ameen. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Subhanakallahumma wa bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.